Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to a second game of the night with Lobby loaded in the first time, even though Chicago Ted did his best to jinx it again. But hey,
oh, come on, dude.
We are here with Power Rangers versus HellRaisers, their second best one in this particular league. Doesn't really matter for the standings, as Vega is home and host with a 12-2 score in this group, so it's pretty much just a practice scrim for these two teams, but should be a pretty good game nonetheless. Also, for all of you guys who are asking, is this not Na'Vi versus Empire? Obviously, that game got postponed, unfortunately, indeed. Would have loved to cast them, but, well, PR and HellRaisers is all we got. As far as I'm concerned, it's good enough for me. So, hey, similar kind of bands here. This time around, though, the Vengeful Spirit taken out by Power Rangers, not willing to give that over to HellRaisers, and they, in turn, they ban out Big Gnome's Chen. So, a little bit of a difference here already.
Yeah, and it seemed the Big Gnome's Chen actually ended up accomplishing more than we thought it would that last game. I think coming out of the laning stage, we figured, you know, it wasn't really ganking, it wasn't doing a whole lot, but ended up being a pretty pivotal piece of their mid to late game prowess. And even though they didn't end up being able to take the game, it still had an impact. So getting rid of it is just a pure respect from HellRaisers not wanting to deal with it again. The Venge ban was smart, but that still leaves Witch Doctor in the pool for HellRaisers, which is arguably their more comfortable hero. So having that in the pool just means that Power Rangers need to be incredibly careful. Maybe they want to avoid running something like the Beastmaster again because of how the cask interacted with him and his boar. But we'll have to see as HellRaisers, they'll pop that out with a Faceless Void immediately. And, you know, I haven't really seen them play this hero all that much, but they seem to like the Faceless Void Witch Doctor combo. If they get it, well, I hope Power Rangers have what it takes to deal with it, or else it might end up being able to screw them over.
Faceless Void Witch Doctor is one of these classic combos that, obviously with the Chronosphere and then the ward on the outside. I mean, you used to be able to just place the ward wherever, even inside the Chronosphere, it would still fire. It's not the case anymore, so you have to be a little bit more careful with the Chronosphere positioning, but this level of play, you do expect that to be rather easy for these players, but gonna go with the Oracle for now, so that defensive support to keep them alive, maybe setting up for something like an OD for the middle lane, something more greedy that can really benefit from that False Promise later down the line, get so many extra right clicks in. Invoker Bane, though, for Power Rangers, that's a really, really strong combo, just because you have, of course, the Invoker, solid mid laner, with the Sunstrike, able to benefit from the Bane Nightmare setup anywhere on the map.
Yep. One thing about the Oracle, he's really helpful against someone like the Invoker. I think maybe they want to grab the Witch Doctor, but they figured the Oracle would be too big to pass up. I mean, you've got a spell that can pretty much negate everything but the Sunstrike coming from the Invoker, which is that Fate's Edict blocking out the magic damage. So that is really useful to have. If someone gets set up by the Bane Nightmare combo, you drop it on them, and no matter what comes, unless it's just a straight Sunstrike, then they should be able to survive. Of course, Brain Sap is also pure damage, so maybe that might not be too strong in the long run, but we'll have to see. As it's still pretty potent support, a lot of heal, and a lot of just raw sustain. Ends up being sort of like a better Dazzle, except operates in a different sense, so we'll have to see exactly how much of an impact he'll have in the end of the game. But Power Rangers, of course, this combo is really strong. Whether the Bane and the Invoker is a straight combo, or they have someone else to go very well with the Bane, a lot of heroes can end up comboing pretty well. Of course, naturally, we know the Mirana tended to be one of the stronger pickups, but not quite sure if that's the direction they want to go this game around. Certainly ends up bringing to mind a couple other ones that end up being really powerful. So we'll see. In the end, though, Death Prophet and Broodmother have been banned out. As far as where they go with these lineups, again, the Witch Doctor can still come out for the HellRaisers. Other heroes they've grabbed with the Faceless Void. It doesn't really make a difference because none of these heroes are known to go with the Faceless Void, but we've seen the Weaver, the Batrider being very popular, the Winter Wyvern also being popular for HellRaisers. But it seems that when they run him, they like to run him as a carry, so we'll have to see how that operates this game. But Power Rangers, they go with the Shadow Shaman. That one's an interesting one. I don't think I would have expected that to come out.
Well, more single target lockdown, so if you do get on top of the Faceless Void, you have more ways to just deal with them, especially early on in lane, if that's going to be a concern for Power Rangers. If you want to put on pressure on them early, no matter what lane he's in, You need very long, reliable lockdown, like the
Trying
Shadow
something
Shaman is able to
remaining.
provide you with, unless you have some sort of disable that can stop him from
5 seconds
shackling.
remaining.
But yeah, I mean, with the Bane, with the Shadow Shaman, you have a decent amount of time to bring down Faceless
Reserve
Void before he
time.
can get the Time Walk off and undo all the damage that you did to him. So
Dire
maybe that's the
team
reasoning
picked.
here. Maybe they just want to get a little bit of extra push from the wards later down the line, just have a similar game to last, but this time around a little bit of a better way to go high ground as well, and than they had before with the gen. And just pop down the wards, make HellRaisers fight around that if they want to defend.
Oh yeah. Well, yeah, you can't let
Ten
Shadow Shaman
seconds
get close to
remaining.
your base. I don't think HellRaisers, they have many ways to deal with those wards. Of course,
Five
Oracle, a
seconds
very
remaining.
long range as well as a low cast or low attacks point, so he should be able to deal with the wards pretty well.
Reserve
But
time.
for the moment, I think Shadow Shaman, he's going to control the pace of this game once his level 6 comes about. You push down towers, you force HellRaisers to play on the defensive, and that's what the game is going to end up becoming about. HellRaisers, I like the Disruptor pickup a lot, because you can control a hero like Bane and Invoker if you can catch them in the Static Storm, but mostly HellRaiser's lineup feels a little weak right now as far as physical damage goes. The Faceless Void doesn't end up being the best carry, at least not in the current meta. He's got a lot of damage coming out, but he also can end up being very
Tide
squishy,
Hunter.
and if you lock him down, he's not going to just be able to time
Radiant
walk away
team
from the
picked.
damage. So HellRaisers, they've got to either pick themselves up a very good initiator to go along with that Faceless Void, a tanky initiator too. So if they want to run him as a carry, they'll grab something like a
Devourer.
Beastmaster on top of it,
Dire
which
team
they
back.
played pretty well last game. They'll start out with an Invoker, with an Outer World Devourer though. Both of them are OP heroes, so I guess they're interchangeable. But
Pretty much.
Outer World Devourer actually tends to be a fairly decent matchup to go up against the Invoker. It
10
kind of comes
seconds
down to your
remaining.
playstyle, and of course, Arise's Invoker is very difficult to deal
5
with, but
seconds
I
remaining.
think Illidan, or not Illidan, sorry,
Alphan and J, yeah. Should be
yeah.
taking that
Reserve
OD.
time.
Yeah, tends to be really good to go up against it, but his Puck was pretty well in the last game, so maybe we'll see him dominate as the Outer World Devourer this game. In the end, though, for a one-on-one of equal skill, I think the OD does end up coming out on top just a little bit, because of how well he can dominate against intelligence-based heroes. But for right now, we'll see how well Arise can play this matchup, because I imagine he's played it a lot
Oh yeah.
in his pub. So we'll see. Tidehunter picked up for Power Rangers, a really good initiator, a good way to lock down the Faceless Void if he tries to initiate too. So I'm liking this one. I think they've got a lot of teamfight control from the PR standpoint, but Hellraisers still, with the OD,
Radiant
have a good
team
amount of
back.
damage. We'll see if they pick up an offlaner or a carry for
Dire
this last
team
pick, though,
picked.
as it seems Power Rangers think that they're going more for a Faceless Void offlane, and they're going to be picking up a carry for this last pick.
The Void offlane is kind of the go-to strat for most teams that
It
pick up that
is,
hero,
yes.
just because you have that utility from the Chronosphere without really having to worry about the damage output. Because to do that, Faceless Void needs a lot of damage and a lot of attack speed. None of
10
that,
seconds
which it
remaining.
doesn't have anything of that inherently, so it needs a lot of items for that, and consequently a lot of
5
farm.
seconds remaining.
Yeah, it's
So
probably going to be an offlane.
ideally you have a Dota carry, maybe a ranged carry like the
Reserve time.
gyrocopter, rather popular together with that. But even melee carries can work out well if they have some sort of follow-up to the Chronosphere, right? That's what we see sometimes as Sven, of course, banned out this time around, but would have
10
been one of
seconds
the more common
remaining.
pickups that I've seen together with the Faceless Void, even though you don't have the
5 seconds remaining.
direct synergy, just being able to hit inside the Chronosphere, you have to
Radiant
follow up with
team
your own
picked.
stun and your own damage after the fact. So, PR?
I'm wondering what they're going to give Illidan this time around. I mean, obviously they can't give him the Morphling. They might be able to get away with something like a CK this time around. You can pull someone out. They're going to
Side.
go with a Naga. So a similar kind of illusion-based hero, I guess, but that's a really interesting pickup. I don't think I've seen a core Naga Siren in God knows how long. So Illidan Naga. Well, we're in for a treat this time
Yeah.
around, as we're taking a blast from the past.
Bit of a different lineup, so that'll mean that they will rely on the Outworld Devourer to do the damage here in the early phase, together with the Faceless Void, backed up by Oracle and Disruptor, just to create space for the Naga Siren here. But I really like this pickup as well, up against the Lycan. mean, you have a lot of really strong ways to actually deal with them, which makes me wonder if there was a good pick out there for PR. I mean, you do have to face the Chronosphere, obviously. You have to disrupt, you can glimpse them back if you keep the vision, and obviously the
10 seconds
kinetic field can keep
remaining.
him in. You have the OD to just trap him for 4 seconds, waste some of the
Five
time with the
seconds
ultimate, and now
remaining.
also Naga Siren Net that even goes through BKB. So I'm not sure if PR really thought this last pick through.
Yeah, it's gonna be interesting. I think they've got enough of a team
Prepare
to
for
push
battle.
down in this sort of weak period that you inherently have with a Naga Siren as your carry. But this is Illidan we're talking about. I mean, that weak point exists also for a hero like Morphling, and of course, it meant nothing to this guy. So we'll have to see exactly how his farm's gonna be. But yeah, I'm struggling to find who I'd favor in this draft. I mean, last game, I was very, confident that HR had won the drafting phase. I gave it a 70-30. I was very, very vocal about it. But this game, I don't really know who I'd put on top. I think I still give HR a little bit, or sorry, I gave PR last game, I think, the advantage. But I think I give HR a little bit of an advantage in this game because it's Illidan's Naga Siren, and you've got an OD. These are two heroes that, for Illidan specifically, is really scary, and the OD in general is really scary. And I like the matchup against an Invoker. So I will give him a little bit of an advantage, but it's nowhere near what I gave Pierre last game. I'd say, if not a 50-50, a 55-40. To be extreme, maybe a 60-40, but whatever the case, I give HR only a slight advantage.
So if PR wants to come out ahead in this game, they definitely have to make the early game count. They have to make sure to use the Bane to set up the kills everywhere. They have to make sure to use the Shadow Shard with wards on cooldown to take tower after tower after tower to just once again restrain
30
the space
seconds
that
to battle.
HR and Illidan has to farm. But we'll see how it works out as we get into the game. If you guys are just tuning in, welcome. My name is Dragondrop, bringing you the second best of one and the WePlay League Season 3 today. Between HellRaisers and Power Rangers. No Na'Vi versus Empire. That one got postponed, so you can stop spamming the chat with that. Thank you.
Yeah, they're not gonna stop
They're
that,
not gonna
dude.
stop now.
Give not the Empire, man. I want it too, dude. I wanted it too.
Well, you don't hear
The
us
battle
just
begins.
crying about the whole game now, do we? All right.
Blue God engaged.
It, it's sad, but hey, HellRaisers versus Power Rangers. Good matchup as far as I'm concerned, anyway. So let's take a look at our lineup, starting with the top lane here. Chatelo, he's been playing a little bit of a ward up in this top spot, scouting out what has happened on the Faceless Void offlane. In the mid lane, we've got Alpha Ninja playing that Outworld Devourer. Down the bottom lane, we're gonna have a bit of a tri lane here with Illidan on that carry, Naga Siren, Goddamn playing the Oracle, and YW holding up the Creeper Wave here, dealing with Cheshire Cat.
Yep, taking that extra right click from the range creep, which was meant for a creep, so they might have a little
Actually
bit of
gonna
pull
go
here. But
early.
Cheshire Cat.
Fortune's End channeled out for quite a bit. Illidan already has the Riptide to lay in that extra bit of damage here. And actually gonna get it.
I'm
Really,
honestly
that's a cracking
surprised
shot.
Illidan didn't chase. I mean, I guess he wanted a couple last hits and felt it was more important, but one more wave or Riptide would have been enough to bring down Cheshire Cat. At the moment, though, they will pop his salve, so that is gone for now. As Afro Ninja having a little bit of trouble, J4 is camping him in the mid lane. This is really
Oh,
important,
bottom
as
lane.
I said.
This is it. I'm gonna go again.
Yeah.
I was gonna say there was very little mana used to pop the big amount of regen there from Tidehunter. And then Cheshire
Yeah.
Cat going in again straight after. A little bit of misplay from him, uncharacteristic misplay at that. It's normally a very
Yeah,
solid
well.
offlaner, so hey.
This is the power of an Oracle. He makes offlaners' lives hell because of the way you can immediately catch someone out of position and hold them for a very long time. I mean, we're talking about 2.5 second stun after a little bit of charge can mean the difference between a dead and alive offlaner. And we just saw it happen again. J4 now making his way to Afro Ninja in the mid lane, but it's gonna come out to the same effect that it did last time, where just a little bit of harass either way, but no one's in any danger of dying. The big thing here, though, is that Cheshire Cat, if he struggles a lot in this off lane, then a Tidehunter who doesn't have a lot of gold is a moot Tidehunter. So we'll have to see how he can recover from this, as Shashlo has been having a pretty equal amount of trouble as
Lando.
all mid.
Well, speaking of trouble, Alpha Ninja eats the fairy fights. I don't know though. keep him safe up against the right clicks. I mean, he did get the imprisonment off on the rise, but J4 was the one controlling him with a nightmare in turn, so they were able to get that combo off with the Sunstrike. Now, Shachalos here to, well, kind of make use of that a little bit, grab a last hit or two, as he once again hasn't really been able to put on pressure in this offlane.
Well, you can't really go top because you're going up against a huge amount of single target lockdown between Big Num when he's there. J4 also, if he's not ganking the mid, can get a nightmare and set something up for Keanu, or Keanu, I guess, to bring him down. So he's got to be incredibly careful. If you were to go up there, figures it's not worth his time. Rather just jungle, which he can do pretty effectively with the Iron Talon, pretty much becoming the go-to item for any straight-up right-clicking off-laner. So Cheshire Cat will also go into his own sort of off-lane hard camp and bring that down with a couple of anchor smashes, get some experience in gold from that. And that will keep the game relatively even for now, but of course, Power Rangers getting that first kill on Afrininja is incredibly important. Get Arise the advantage he needs to just snowball away with this Invoker.
J4 doesn't show any signs of letting up. He found himself in Arcane Rune, just to be able to spam out the Brain Sap even more. It's a 42 mana cost. Very low cooldown. This is so obnoxious to deal with. I mean, it's gonna run out now, so it's back to 100 mana, but still. And he's been spending a lot of time in this middle lane to, as you said, give Arise that good time. And if you look at the other side, neither YW nor Goddamn really have the same kind of ability to do that as a Bane does. Sure, you have a bit of defensive capability here with the Oracle, but that's about it. You're not going to be able to trade hits.
I think Oracle's got a sizable amount of advantage. He's got a huge nuke with the Purifying Flames and the Fortune's End, so he should be able to accomplish something if he babysits Afrininja, but for now, it seems they don't really want to commit too hard to this, and I think Afrininja is just going to have to play this one really far back and really careful, because as we saw, a Nightmare is enough to bring him down. If he gets caught, even at half HP, he is going to go down. So for now, if you're not going to babysit him, he's got to play this one very careful, and they've got to make something, some use of the rest of the map, and it doesn't seem like they're doing that really effectively.
He, as I said, he's playing it very well. Just taking pot shots here when he can onto the Bane, but immediately turning around. Goddamn also kind of erring on the side of caution. Obviously, since they don't have to babysit Illidan and bottom lane again, as they have forced Cheshire Cat out, it leaves these players once again to one. One of them can just do stacks and pull to get XP, the other one just looks for stuff to do elsewhere on the map. Chachalo at the same time also forced back into the jungle, not quite as effective as the Tidehunter is though. On the other side of the map, Cheshire Cat already level 5, even though his hard camp here got blocked off YW's rotation a little bit earlier.
I'm surprised here. 5 minutes in, we don't have a Flying Courier on the side of HellRaisers, and it's almost as if they're expecting Goddamn to buy it, which he doesn't have a whole lot of gold. He has been mostly just kind of around the map forcing people back and babysitting. He hasn't exactly been farming, or at least had a chance to hit a creep with zero last hits to his name. And of course, YW, he had enough gold for it, but now, okay, spent it on the Flying Courier. All right, so that's pretty important to get that out. Very nice. But in the meantime, I mean, we're still 1-1, 6 minutes in, not a hugely kill intensive game. We saw this same sort of thing last game where neither team is really trying to make that much happen in the early game, rather just go for the little things that can grab an advantage that aren't kills. So Shashlo still farming up in his own jungle. Illidan is getting a whole lot of gold without too much contest on the bottom lane, and top, Goddamn's been taking the offlaner role as Shashlo cannot be here, and they'll try to punish that with J4 trying to come from behind, maybe look for a Nightmare Sunstrike combo.
Goddamn sees it though. They have this ward up top here.
Yeah.
Both teams have a ward, but obviously the one on the Radiant side spotting out that rotation, making sure that nothing will happen to anyone trying to soak experience. But that means that this tier 1 will fall pretty damn soon with Lycan. Obviously, him getting free farm means very, very early Vladimir's offering. Just went straight forward, not even taking a detour to any boots or anything. So, yeah. And yeah, this is where PR starts taking towers once again, left, right, and center.
Yep.
I mean, maybe a little bit of a better lineup than they had last time around, even with Chen, with the way they played it.
I mean, yep.
Just because you don't really expect earlier gank rotations coming out as you would expect with a Chen on your team. So
it's not just towers too. Once Bignum hits level 6, they can easily take a Roshan with Keanu having the Vladimir's offering and the wards up hitting the big guy himself. So if they want to use it for a tower, more power to them. If they want to use it for the quick Aegis, also a very decent thing to get out of it. So they'll just put a huge amount of damage on the top tier 2 and then walk away, maybe get a little bit of experience on their Shadow Shaman, and then do the same thing again, maybe in a different area, same area, doesn't make a difference. The rest of the map, I mean, is going all right for the Power Rangers. I mean, Cheshire Cat has got his level 6 by jungling it up and getting rid of that camp, and they are going to go ahead and protect the Roshan too, make sure that the Lycan can't just take it. Of course, J4 is also having a decent amount of decent time. Arise having a fantastic time in the mid. So the game is going pretty well for Power Rangers. HR, still, you've got a whole lot of farm going in to Illidan, who is at 3K gold now, 8 minutes in. We might be looking at the famed 14-minute Radiance, which could split this game wide open for HellRaisers if they're able to get it that early. That would eliminate most pushes from Power Rangers and hugely accelerate the farm of this Naga Siren.
This is the kind of future sight that we have to have right now. I mean, with the way this game's been going, it wouldn't be too surprising if we see a similar situation in the last game where HellRaisers, they may be losing some map control here and there, but they're still going to get the farm on Illidan. And ultimately, the question is that enough to keep PR away from high ground? And unless they get caught out, I don't think it is, because at some point, as you said, the Radiance will be online, Illidan will start exploding in farm, will get more and more tanky items to just make sure that the illusions are really, really hard to deal with for PR. I mean, they have a decent amount of control. The hex, obviously, from Shadow Shaman instantly annihilates one of them, but obviously there's 3 plus 2 from Momentum Style eventually, so it's not going to make too much of a difference. Not like a line where you also have the Mana Drain to annihilate one on 4 or 5 second cooldown, so yeah. This Naga Siren can have the potential to be a big, big nuisance for Power Rangers, which is why I'd actually like to see them start putting on more pressure on Illidan. Let's bring Keanu down. He has the boots now too, so just take control of the bottom side of the map. Just try and restrict Naga Siren's farm before the Radiance comes out, but not gonna have much time for that. He almost has a relic.
Right, and before the Cheshire Cat came down to contest Illidan, because he could, Illidan had perfect CS. So now he's probably 5 or 6 creeps off from it. Actually, 5 creeps exactly off from it, but that's still pretty huge. The fact that he was using this free farm to perfectly farm the lane and do a fantastic job at that, I mean, that's going to mean that fast radiance we were talking about. He's got the gold for the relic now at 10 minutes in. And with that relic, I mean, he's only about 1,000 gold now off from having the full completed Radiance, which is easy for him to farm in a couple of minutes. So the 14-13 minute Radiance is definitely possible unless they make an expedition into his jungle to kill him. So look for Illidan to be the big player here as PR. They will go for a push in the mid lane. They are going to spend the wards, not for the Roshan, but for tier 1 tower. So they are going to get this one without too much contest and should be able to muscle down the rest of the towers to follow suit. Or just go after the Roshan now, whatever they want to do. The world is their oyster. They just got to be careful of Illidan's constant threat.
Might look like a bit of an overcommitment there, popping the wards on a tier 1 tower, especially after the Lycan throw, but just a matter of just making absolutely sure that there's no contest coming out from HellRaisers. But now just going to, as you said, muscle down to tier 1 and bottom without that. And the question is, what does HR do in turn? We look at the top lane. Got Arthur and Jade rotating out just to put on a little bit of counter pressure. Obviously, not quite the pressure that a Lycanthrope is. You won't be able to really trade. But they're getting their farm, right? They're getting their items up and running. And it might be just a drums there for the OD with the Robe of the Magi and the Bracer already up and running. So just more stats to play with.
They just gotta be careful to secure some farm for Illidan. Because they lost that tier 1 tower, that push slowed down Illidan's farm substantially. And he'll make his way into the jungle now, which is exactly what he needs to do to keep his farming speed up and running. But they've gotta just be sure that they keep him at the top of the net worth board. I think he is falling behind Keanu, who's been doing a fantastic job at getting his farm and pushing. Kind of the sleeper cell of this game. We didn't really expect him to be that high up, but these pushes have been helping him out a lot. But Illidan, he's got to stay at least in second place, and with that Radiance, quickly overtake up for the first place, because, I mean, him slowing down is a death sentence for HR. He's one of those things that you cannot let him get pressured.
Unless, well, PR, they're gonna get the Roshan, tier 1 will possibly be traded here up on top lane for it. It's gonna give Illidan a little bit of a gold boost, but what I'm more worried about is PR just straight up converging right on top of Illidan right after this. They have some aggressive vision placed down in the Radiant side jungle, both to secure the Roche as well as to just spot out Illidan and jump on him when you get the chance. That being said though, I mean, with level 6, you can always song and TP out. There's no BKBs or anything yet on the side of PR, which is maybe why they're not really feeling comfortable committing too much onto Illidan. It's just TPing out.
That was a nice
lane.
TP.
Oh, yeah. Chronosphere. Cheshire Cat, YW also committing his own combo to try and bring down his Titan. Nice defensive Nightmare here, giving a little bit more time. Now the Fiend's Quarren Chacho, Sunstrike comes out, but he does get the Time Walk out thanks to that false promise, but the Ravage will catch two. YW just swiped down by the Wolf eventually. But Chachler, in the meantime, got enough mana out for another Time Walk up the high ground, so he will survive. They only lose the support, but they use a lot of big ultimates here for that pickoff attempt on the tanky Titan that raids the stun, but they're gonna lose another tier 2 for it.
Yep. The importance of getting that Roshan. Keanu is ahead of the board. He's got so much gold behind him. He's got a lot of experience behind him, and he's hitting like a truck. We saw YW just get chewed up, quite literally, so even though this Radiance is out, we still have a Naga who's fairly squishy. You can see those two illusions have been brought down very quickly. I think he prioritizes illusions, so they are the tankiest they will ever be without him tanking himself up. So this is pretty important. They've got to make use of this time that Illidan's still a little squishy, still a little weak, and bring down everything they possibly can. They've gone after the tier 2 bottom now and should be able to further eliminate any sort of map control that HR have, but now with this Radiance, they might try to take a fight, they might try to win a fight, or at least get a defense. Could it be worth it?
Well, Trisha Gap doesn't have his ultimate. Actually, almost bursts it down here. Sunstrike in the back, just scouting on, actually hitting on YW, but there's Illidan with the Sog initiating. Alpha Ninja is ready with the ultimate. Might need to right click a little bit more to actually get the damage out. YW with the combo too. Doesn't actually get the kinetic field off. Arise should still end up dying here. Oh, actually, he does get the Ghostwalk off. Still alive. Keanu dropping low. He does have the Aegis though. Alpha Ninja barely kept alive by the false promise, but it's not enough. Goddamn, trying to right click. He pops the Aegis, but there's a Fiend's Grip on him. Self imprisonment there, enough on Ninja, but it's only delaying the even Admiral. 2-for-1 trade so far. And PR, well, they're still on the hunt. YW here, just desperately trying to keep them away as Bignum showing off his shiny new Blink Dagger. And picked up a little bit earlier. Might even, if he wants to dive in, he could go for YW. But instead, just scouting the wrong way, but still a great fight for PR. He used their Aegis, but all that we lost was a Titan Hunter who didn't have his ultimate anyway. And
yeah,
they bring down OD. They bring down it's kind of the big story there, right? Bring down OD.
And yeah, I think that fight would have been completely different if Shashlo didn't have a 30-second cooldown in his Chronosphere. Yeah. Like, there were three heroes grouped up. In fact, I think there was a spot where he could have gotten four in that Chrono, but without it, they weren't able to lock people into that static storm, get the guaranteed damage off, and that fight kind of went to a worse place for HR than they would have hoped. Still, though, they're able to get PR back. They get a couple of kills, if not one or two, and they say, hey, guys, we're willing to fight you. So now HR, I mean, our PR need to be a little bit more careful about where they take their fights, but still, I mean, Illidan's not that powerful just yet. The Radiance Burn isn't an end-all for them. And PR, they just need to regroup and continue taking some fights, maybe get a little bit more advantage as they've pretty much taken control of PR's jungle right now, or of HR's jungle right now.
And the Radiance is the start of the timer for the Naga Siren. It's not the point where you can just say, GG, well played, go next. You still need time to get the Manta style, to get the heart, the butterfly, or whatever tanky items you want to pick up on the tier to make sure that the illusions are actually impossible to just right click down. Radiance Burn is nice, but right now it's not keeping PR away from the base, which is the biggest story here. They're hitting the timings perfectly well. And yeah, just it's not just evident by the farm on Lycan, but also on Big Gnome. Shadow Shaman almost has more net worth than the OD on side of HR. Now they can commit the level 1 ward still, but still, set of wards up on a tier 3 tower, all the way down below half health. HR, all that we have is Chronosphere, they're gonna need to find a good one, but which all the ultimates are up for PR still. Teamfight ultimates, anyway.
They gotta be pretty careful with these.
Glimpse back onto Cheshire Cat into the Static Storm here. Can't get his ultimate off. He will be bursted down. Now the Chronosphere in the back on three heroes up in the gym on the outside. Will be able to right click down J4. Big number on the rise. Still alive though. They get the big meatball come off. Absolutely everyone. Keanu's there. Ready to swipe out. But Illidan trying to stop that with the song. Will be able to. Both supports down. Keanu's still looking for more. But Ryze would right click down, and now there's everything else left for that lycanthrope. And yeah, if he's one right clicking you, he's still gonna be fine. It does end up getting out from NJ, but it was still a huge fight for HR to take.
A full-on wipe for them. They only lose Avernage and YW even after a brilliantly placed combo coming out from PR. I mean, that should have been the combo that ended it, but the immediate follow-up from the Song of the Siren that stopped PR from doing anything after that, and then the Fate's Edict that they put onto the Lycanthrope, which kept them from doing any damage to follow-up itself, it was a pretty big thing there. But another major point is that they drop all the wards, they get all the summons, they push down the tower, they don't get the tower and HR clean up all of it. So all of that gold that they just swung away with that one fight, it's going to start stacking up. If the Naga Siren is able to bring down the Necronomicon units, that's at a level 2 Necronomicon, that's 300 gold every single time. When you get upgrades it to level 3, it'll be 400 gold every time. But that's another hero kill for the Naga Siren's worth of gold that you can't be giving her. You just cannot let her get anything after getting that radiance. Now she's got 2,000 gold. She's going to buy herself a Boots of Travel to go on top of that. So her split push is going to become incredibly scary. She's a harder to kill, not impossible, but the Song of the Siren makes it very difficult. And I mean, it's just becoming a real big issue now.
Siren's
on
cooldown though. Illidan teleport himself to the middle lane. Cheshire Cat commits the Ravage here, gets it in the edge. And then FJ4 with the follow up. Fiend's Grip and
Caster's Curse.
Well, why did you have to do it? That was just greed from Illidan though. I mean,
yeah.
It was just straight up. It wasn't cooldown for another 20 seconds here, teleporting right into the middle lane where tier 1 is still standing, mind you. So, it's just, I mean, big commitment with two ultimates there from J4 as well as Cheshire Cat with the Ravage, but definitely worth it. Just killing Illidan for the first time in this game. And
First
time in both games, exactly. And now, well, that being down, 20 seconds should be more than enough time to bring down a tier 3 and perhaps one of the racks. Everyone's here. Creepave is going to catch up soon here. They don't have back to another Blink Hacks onto Goddamn here. They bring it down, maybe not, with the defensive imprisonment here. Grow Gurnals 3 on 3. Cheshire Cat in the front line is taking a lot of damage. They're still alive with defensive Nightmare. Shashua dropping low. A couple of extra right clicks from the wards, and Bignum will be able to bring him down. So that's Chronosphere out of the picture. Keanu gets glimpsed back. Oh, no real commitment there. Afternoon J dropping low. Can't really get too close to the wards here, but they lock him down near the melee racks. Be able to finish you off, and the range tracks are still standing here. Could have been right clicking those to actually trade something for a skill, but Lycan once again giving his life over for a cause.
I'm not quite sure I like their style here. I mean, just kind of rolling against the towers like the tide rolling in only works if you know you constantly get stronger and stronger and the enemy just withers away. But HR, every single time they go in, HR are getting stronger. They're taking a chunk out of PR's total lead. I mean, you can see it's kind of gone down nearly every single time. Now they've got a little bit of an experience advantage. And by a little bit, I mean a very, very little bit. But the main point here is that HR are not getting weaker with every single push. If they lose Arrakis, they don't care. They've got the Naga Siren with the split push. If they lose a couple of heroes, they don't care because they're trading away just as much, if not more, each time. So I don't really like the whole style that's being played by Pierre, and I think eventually it's going to become an issue where even if they drop everything, their base doesn't get scratched because the wards are dying very quickly, HR are taking the superior fights, and Pierre are just getting weaker and weaker. Their items are still sort of coming out. I mean, I don't think I've seen Keanu get anything major since buying the Necronomicon book, aside from leveling it up. But we're about to have an Aghanim Scepter on a rise get completed. We've got Big Num with that Blink Dagger, that shiny Blink Dagger, Cheshire Cat with an Aghanim Scepter on the way, and J4, I mean, the Glimmer Kid is pretty decent for him.
Arise blinks right into Shadow here. The glints back after the Dust and Ghostwalk here. And the Meatball will miss. YW committing his whole combo. Make absolutely sure that this Invoker ends up falling here. But Big Num is there to make the trade happen. X on Shadow. Got him is there, but caught with the Fiend Script. Not before Gunfall from us out now. Well, bit of a waste there with the Chronosphere on top of the Imprisonment. They should still be able to bring down this Bane. But at the same time, Roshan is fallen. Cheshire Cat and the Lycanthrope are coming in to try and help. Big Num will fall, but there's a Ravage. Gets out for Ninja, but hey, no, Illidan says stop the fun. Pops a Song to Siren, saves his friends. It should be a good one, unless they can catch up. No ultimate pop there from Lycan actually timed out, so Keanu unable to chase any further. A big play there from HellRaisers. Absolutely, to keep everyone else alive. These crucial heroes that you need to defend high ground. I mean, you need the damage output from the OD. No question about that.
Pierre still got the Roshan, though. I mean, during that entire time, they got the Roshan, they made their way in. They also used the Naga Siren's old Song of the Sirens. So that is a level 2 song, which means the cooldown isn't that massive, but it still puts it on cooldown, which gives 80 or so seconds right now from this point for Pierre to try to make a massive push or take a big team fight, as Pierre have all come back alive. They're ready to fight. No big ultimates yet, but none are on a substantially high cooldown aside from the Ravage, so they should have everything they need to fight very soon, whereas the Chronosphere, 40 seconds, the Song of the Siren, 60, might be enough, but it looks like they're not going to try to make any aggressive plays. Just get back, farm up, and, you know, try to get the next couple of items out.
You definitely need the Shadow Shaman rewards if you want to go high ground. You definitely need need the Titan there as a backup, or even as a frontliner, even if the Ravage is used. We've seen Cheshire Cat just push himself into the forefront of the fight just to tank damage. I mean, he's sitting at 1800 health points as a mechanism, working on the Aghanim Scepter, making him a little bit tanky already with the point boost and the Ogre Club.
Yep.
And that between the Kraken Shell and the Anger Smash as well, he can actually tank quite a bit of damage and just create space and time for PR to whack away at the buildings. Just have to make sure that they can actually use that ability to their full effectiveness.
Yeah, the issue with raw tank against heroes like OD, and especially someone like OD or Slark, is that the more hits that you allow to be done to you, the more, I guess in this case, intelligence you steal. So Afroninj, if he just is able to sit and whack on the Tidehunter, doesn't matter how tanky he is, eventually Afroninj is going to come out with a huge amount of intelligence, which leads to big ulties, big right clicks, and
speaking of big ulties, Illidan, find him with the hacks, but Shashra comes in with the Chronosphere on top of the Static Storm here. Rise dropping low, will end up falling, perhaps not quite yet. Kept alive with Cheshire Cat, now there's wards coming out. Rise will end up falling, but what's still clicking away at the Faceless Void? Despite Illidan's song this time around, not enough to keep him safe. They catch Illidan with the Nightmare. False Promise comes out. They need a Fiend Script here. They get it on the YW in the back. Keanu joining in, but caught with the Fortune then as his ultimate also runs out. Cheshire Cat finally gets his own ultimate off. After Ninja, the pot doesn't care. He has a PKB. He just right clicks him down. Actually, goddamn sneaks the kill away, but hey. 2-for-1 trade so far, the rest of PR on the run as they're dropping super, super low. Keanu, well, that's a big kill if they can get it here. And do get the glimpse back before the TP, and yeah, there's no way for him to run. Not with a kinetic field coming out. After that, she's sitting on the outside. And poor little wolf. Well, just one right, there we go. Goddamn again, with the range on this thing. This spell is just, Aetherlands Gaming.
Hero is so annoying.
Oh. Purifying phase, man.
Alright, so right now we've got the third or fourth time in a row that PR have taken a full-on all-out push in to bring down a Brax or at least a tower that has failed. So we're approaching critical mass right now for HR. We've got a Naga Siren who throughout all of this still has only died once, and that was that one point where it didn't really mean all that much. She's been constantly farming. Style now, and maybe another kill.
For all the good your scraps have earned.
Oh, did we panic a little bit there? Ah. Oh, after Ninja in the top, the Fiends grip the Sunstrike. They've got everything to bring him down, and Arise comes up just to follow up. He's able to get himself with the Astral Imprisonment, but yeah. Do they? Wait. Okay, they see him. Tornado gave him enough vision to spot out where he was there, a blink right on top of him. But yeah, I wasn't sure if he was going to be possible for him to get away from that one. Still, it's worth the effort, right? In the end, though, they get a nice little pickoff on Aphra Ninja. Still, the Naga Siren's a little dead right now, so she can't exactly farm or split push. This is fairly good for PR, but I've still struggled to find a way that they can actually push off this one, as Cheshire Cat in a lot of trouble here. Doesn't end up getting caught by the kinetic field, or at least purges off the Fortune's End, and they will Chronosphere him. So, he's dead, but... Yeah. Yeah, this Roshan's going to be really important. I figure at this point, HR might be confident enough to contest their Roshan. And if that happens, I mean, if HR gets the Roshan, then this game might very well be over. I won't call it because, I mean, stranger things can happen. But the main gist would be it's exactly like a last game. They take a fight, they get the Roshan, the amount of advantage that you get off that, plus the fact that I think HR have the harder late game carries and bigger late game power. I mean, it becomes a near impossible game for them. That PR, I think they run out of gas and they just kind of slowly get crippled away. So HR, they might want to think about taking that Roshan fight when it comes back alive, and certainly in a minute, plus some randomized timer, it will be possible for them. But in the meantime, Pierre needs to figure out a way to make sure they can get that Roshan uncontested and have some plan to break the high ground, whether it comes from a pickoff, a smoke, or just raw power, which doesn't seem to be working for them up to this point. Yeah, I think pickoff is the play here. Like, they've got to bring down two without buyback too. Like, that's the kicker. They can't have buyback, because if they do, then HR do take the fight and they do win the fight. Even if they get that pickoff though, I mean, it comes to a point where this Naga Siren is doing a fantastic job at farming up and pushing out the opposite side of the map, that with a pickoff, she can still trade away towers and maybe even force PR to TP back or make a mistake, which ends to them losing the game or losing even more advantage. So it's coming to a struggle point right now. This is the power of the Naga Siren too. You just, if you win a trade, you lose the trade. Like, that's the kind of game style that the Naga Siren plays. And I'm worried right now. I'm actually interested to see exactly how PR plan to deal with this, if they can at all. Yep. Roshan has fallen to the dark. Yep, and their Aegis went to Arise. A combination of things went into that Roshan, though. The quick timer, I think it came off almost immediately after that 1 minute before the random came, and... hold on, yep. I'm kind of interested about their initiation attempt there. Like, they go in for the song, but everyone's so split up that you can't exactly lock someone in with one static storm link and kinetic field in the front, which ended up working pretty well for PR because they've got the BKBs, they had the chance, they've got the Aegis and the cheese to spend, which they didn't have to spend either of them. Major point here is that the wards are casted outside of the base, so they're not going to help with this push, but we do have a buyback on the Naga Siren, which I don't think she wants to spend, but she's going to have to, and they already spent the buyback onto Afro Ninja. If PR win this fight right here, right now, then this is pretty much game because it can easily push down a couple of racks off of it. No tier 2 towers remain, so Mega Creeps are within grasp. If not, just go after the tier 4s. But without the Tidehunter, who didn't get his ultimate off in that fight, might be a little risky. I don't think he can. If he does buy back, he has no way of getting into the fray quickly, too. So it's not really worth him buying back. I don't know if PR want to take this fight here with the BKBs down, but they've got the wolf form at the ready. It's actually going to go down very soon, too. So maybe they just back off here after Illidan buys back.
All right, so my mic should be working in OBS as well. Sometimes, I mean, as much as I love OBS, when it disconnects and then reconnects, somehow, sometimes the mic just doesn't start picking up again. Doesn't start working immediately again. So I have to mute and unmute it again for it to work.
Oh,
which is so annoying. They would be able to hear you, but I was muted there without knowing it. So hey. It was a great teamfight, Cass, and no one's here. I heard it. God damn it. But hey.
We're having a little bit of technical difficulties, yeah. As they are called. I don't know. At this point, I mean, I don't think. I guess Endgame might have been able to hear what I had to say, so it might have been good.
No, they heard you. It's all good. It's all good.
Oh, I saw a co-caster muted in the chat.
Yeah, because sure. They don't know who's the cast and who's the co-caster. Probably.
Ah, I got you. So I think you're Chicago Ted and I'm Dragon Drop, or.
I don't know, man. No,
that's not how it is. But at the moment, all right, because we've still got a huge disadvantage for HRB because Illidan has been disconnecting and reconnecting. May have played a part, actually, in the fact that he died right there.
Yeah.
He could be reconnecting to see what his ping comes back, and if it's bad, then it's bad. But if they play, okay, maybe he's having a huge amount of technical difficulties. Maybe we're not the only ones. But my point still stands right now that I do think that PR might just back off this one. But if they, by some miracle, are able to kill off Illidan again, or kill off Avroninja, or get a wipe, or four dead, or something, after these buybacks, and they will just be able to straight win the game, it might not be worth doing, though. So I do think they will get back. 32 minutes in, though, they might not get another chance to go for a push like this. I mean, they had the Aegis, they had the cheese, they still have them. But the initiation from HR just seemed forced and not really that great. They might not get another chance like that where HR make a botch in initiation.
Yeah, I mean, it was just too greedy from HR, right? They went for two with the static storm combo in the front, and then Faces Void was on back catching two more with the Chronosphere. They didn't focus their initiation too much because PR was doing a really good job just staying away from each other. And despite these two separate initiations almost, Bane was still alive, right? He was able to delay the death of Titan a little bit more with a defensive nightmare, able to throw out the Fiend's Grip. And yeah, that's at the end of the day, that's still a Naga Siren with not much damage items, right? You have a Manta Style,
yep.
You have Radiance, but if you really think about it, who can really right-click on the side of HR? It's still only just EOD.
Naga's still scary, though. I mean, having four units racking on you kind of hurts, but she has built for a more split-push tank style, so that's kind of why it seems like she's a little lackluster, and that's why Keanu has been building very well, because he doesn't really care about the right clicks of Naga Siren. He moves way too fast, and he's way too strong to care about it. The big thing here is that he does a whole lot of damage himself, which, I mean, he can shoo through Afro Ninja quite literally. Chew through Afrodin, chew through Shashlo very well. It's just, it's very tough to deal with a Lycanthrope if you're a Naga Siren, aside from dropping the net on him and hoping your team can follow up and deal the damage. The big kicker here, too, is that Arise with that BKB is also been hitting like a truck and doing a fantastic job. And the supports on the side of PR as well as Tidehunter can deal a good amount of damage on their own. So the Naga Siren, that's why she's felt a little bit lackluster, is not because the hero isn't farmed or doesn't really have a whole lot, is because she doesn't naturally build damage items. She builds more split push, which PR doesn't care about. They just push straight up. So it looks like they will be going for the fight here. I said they would back off, but I was wrong. And they get the ranged racks, but that's all for now. Illidan still hasn't bought back, figuring... I guess that's the reason they're still pushing, is that Illidan hasn't bought back.
Now, with the neck creeps on there, Glyph is forced out. HR, as we said, they don't really actually have any more juice in the tank to fight this Illidan now with the buyback. That'll be the difference here. Keanu's safe with the Glimmer Cape for the time being, but without his ultimate, he's not actually all that fast. They have to go through the ice wall now. Half Ninja's there with the imprisonment. They might be able to bring down Slyken.
Yep. I don't think they're able to win the game off this one or get any major push because he's got a buyback if he has to use it, which I don't think he will. The big thing here is that it's... Wait, what? What?
Sunstrike Gaming.
Oh, boy. That was brilliant by Arise.
Super
but
good.
Yeah. They got the racks, the Necronomicon creeps. I mean, HR didn't really care about killing them. So the creeps got the racks, and of course... There's something almost magical about watching an Alacrity melee Necronomicon creep. Because its attack point is so damn low, the Alacrity just means he's hitting really fast. He's almost like an alchemist in the way he hits, and he does a sizable amount of damage too. So you can't just let him wail on your racks like that, or you lose it, which is exactly what happened. So PR finally get that push they were hoping for, and it was because they were able to bring down Illidan, and he didn't want to buy back. If he had bought back, then the racks wouldn't have fallen, but then you have... Actually, he did buy back. Wait, he bought back way at the end of that one. I don't think that's
back,
worth it at all.
He did buy back. That's what's kind of put PR on the back foot. They were starting to retreat there.
Yeah,
they
but they only,
the
lost,
shot, yeah.
They only lost Keanu. That was not worth it at all for the buyback of Illidan, because if he goes down again, I struggle to see a way that HR defend their base.
He does have the heart now, so it makes it a little bit harder to deal with... both the illusions as well as the real Illidan, obviously, but...
Oh man, they got Afro.
They catch Afro with the Fiendscrip here. Sunstrike, Sheshaket is there. And he bought back too, mind you. That's 80 seconds.
Yep.
On the sidelines as Arise is cliff jungling, because why the hell not?
I was just about to say, dude, like, a pickoff is going to be the big thing here. And I was watching them walk in. I'm like, is he really going to let them do this? But the Fiendscrip, I mean, you don't really let a Fiendscrip happen. It just happens. They take it for themselves, so... HR, they're without OD. They still have Illidan to help with this counter push. And,
oh no, they stack it. Illidan, he can't even stop it because he's stuck in Chronosphere, I think. That was, well, Bignum still caught in the Static Storm, but he just don't have the damage to follow up. Arise with the BKB, Keanu with the BKB. Well, YW just has to run away and cover off the False Promise. Can't really provide anything else. Sunstrike will bring him down. Oh, I guess they did enough damage before the Fortress End anyway, so yes. Now,
oh, no.
Blink Ravage, we finally see here. Chargercat gets two in the back lines. Illidan, well, he's still alive. They can't really kill him, but he can't really do anything about his base being chopped away at either. So, this should be a win for PR. Unless there's,
God.
A divine intervention coming out now, but don't really see it happening.
You know, this looks like a different team from that was playing just 5 minutes ago, 10 minutes ago. They've really found their timings incredibly well, and forcing the two buybacks was huge because now Illidan, he can't play this one aggressively. Like, defending out that one, he had to stay so far back because he couldn't risk dying that he wasn't able to properly take part in the fight, which meant that, boom, he just didn't make any impact, so... At the moment, they're going to try to bring down PR, but the damage is done. The Mega Creeps have happened. And even if they lose everyone, there's still a couple of buybacks they can spend. In fact, everyone on PR has got buybacks. So diving for Mega Creeps, super worth it. They lose everyone, doesn't matter, but it looks like they'll only lose J4 and Keanu on top. Maybe Bignum dies as well. Yeah, it looks like they do.
EKBs galore from both sides. Keanu's still very much alive and kicking. Chashlo, well, once again, the Chronosphere as well as Disruptor Ultimate, just... Not as scary if you don't have the damage to back it up, but eventually the damage comes from Alpha Ninja with that ultimate. Yep. But as you said, the damage has been done. Even though they got a couple of kills now, they are still up against Mega Greaves. I mean, it's a Naga Siren. You can sort of defend, but not really.
Yeah. I also kind of want to bring up from that last fight, like, one of the other things that showed Piero was a different team. That was two botched initiations in a row, I think. Yep. The one in the bottom lane that made them lose their bottom racks was huge. But just the fact that Illidan got caught in the Chronosphere, was not able to drop down his Song of the Siren, made that fight so different. Like, if that fight had been the perfect initiation, Song into a perfect Chronosphere, or even, I think they got the Chrono without the Song too. So just get that initiation without the Song of the Siren there, and you win that fight, because if Pierre tries to counter-initiate, then you've got the Song to stop the counter-initiation, back off and reset. But HR, they botch it, they lose all of their racks, and I mean, it's become a situation where they've got to deal with Mega Creep, something that even a Naga struggles to deal with. It's going to be, you know, you need your Vladimir's offerings, you need your Mjolnir's, but it doesn't seem like anyone's quite within grasp of getting that, as all of PR are really at the top of the net worth. The only one beating them is Illidan, who is rather lackluster right now.
Top lane, Shastro just has to commit the Chronosphere to stop a Riot from killing him. Yes, he has the
60-second cooldown.
Yes, the Aghanim Scepter, but it's still a minute, as you said, so it's now still prime time for PR to finish off the game if they want to.
They're not in any real hurry right now. They've got their items still coming out. This is trouble.
It's a nightmare. Onto Illidan. All possible here with the Fiend's Grip onto him on top of the... Yeah, well, it'll be stopped by the OD. But hey, YW in the back. Can get his ultimate off, but to no avail, really. Doesn't really do anything. Illidan gets the Song up, but BKB on the rise is still wrecking away. Not enough space, though, for the team to get the hell out, maybe not, with the Tornado coming in, self-imprisonment. Only delay the inevitable here for Alpha Ninja, getting straight back into the wards. Want to pick his pick the one that brings him down, but... Yeah, the tier 4s are falling. There's another Chronosphere here, catches it on pretty much everyone though, so pretty good at that regard, but they only bring down Cheshire Cat in the front
to only
spend his ultimate. Yeah, that's what it comes down to here, so ever since the main creeps come out. They're just having some fun, I guess. Still able to do quite a bit of damage to PR's heroes. Keanu even being brought down despite everything else, but Ancient is dropping quite low. So all these creeps, the siege creeps even, don't give a damn, but they're still defending. Why are they still defending?
It's not that bad for them. I mean, there's no point to just GG out of this one, because you still got the Naga Siren, she can still push pretty effectively. Even though Pierre can't buy it back and defend, I mean, the lanes are all pushed out. Mid lane still has a tier 1 tower standing too, so if you're to push top lane, that's a really long lane to try to push, same with bottom. So even though those have less towers, they're kind of not the ones you want to bring down. You really want to just be able to bull rush down mid, right, and end the game, but they can't with the tier 1 still there. So PR are still in a great spot. The Ancient is brought down to half HP by the time they want to fight. Next time, it should only be still a little bit over half. So they can just do that same thing again and expect to be able to close out the game. I mean, even just walking in, popping all your BKBs and hitting it, they have to cast a Chronosphere to stop that, which it worked the last time they were able to stop it. But in the meantime, I mean, Mega Creeps are really tough to fight up against, and I almost want to call the game. I really don't think I should call the game, because there still is a glimmer of hope from HR, but it's really, really small, really faint, and they're about to have another Aegis and Cheese about 5 seconds, 10 seconds more before that Roshan respawns.
Funny thing is, if you look at the graphs, the advantage for PR hasn't never actually been in that ridiculous amount, at that ridiculous number beyond the 20k mark. Neither for gold or for experience. In fact, HR is actually ahead in terms of experience a little bit now. But at the end of the day, it doesn't really matter. Doesn't end up mattering, as the buildings and the throne is all that matters in this game. And of course, also Aegis helps the summon once again back on Keanu. Yeah. They also have Cheese available, who picked that one up.
Arise opting to hold on to his Hand of Midas instead of picking up either the Aegis or Cheese. We'll see how that works out for them.
Oh, Illidan again. Fiendscripts. Nightmare first before the ultimate can come out into the Fiendscript. Perhaps there it is, maybe not. With that, with the Lotus Orb coming out, now they're all nice and grouped up. YW with the follow-up here. This time around with Magnum Scepter, the Count PKB out of those Ryze and Cheshire got both dropping low. Shardslow gets J4 as well as Kian on the back. Afternoon is still alive with the PKB of his big number. Well, the war's not really in position to keep fighting anymore. The glimpse back Keanu into the kinetic field, bring him down, but that's only the Aegis, but he's not gonna have his ultimate form after this. So, yeah, I mean, still gonna fight a little though at this point. That's the kind of fight that he can take quite handily, just one by one, they're dropping low. Charlo gets himself out of trouble. Base is still in trouble, right? Make no mistake, this is actually second set of Serpent Wards. With Bignum coming in, dropping those down to try and red out the Ancient. All the creeps helping out as well, but HR is still holding on. By the skin of her teeth.
Yeah, barely.
Get
I mean,
a 5 and
down Keanu, but so this is why I said they had that glimmer of hope. Yeah. First of all, I really, really think that Arai should have picked up either the Aegis or Cheese instead of the Hand of Midas. Like, him going down there was bigger than anything else in that fight because he really wasn't able to do anything. You drop down the Static Storm, he can't BKB out, he's locked in, they killed him, and that's life. So with about 50 seconds before the full roster of Pierre is back up and alive, that gives Illidan some time to push out the lanes. Now, they still have to be very careful of their Ancient, and Dire still has two glyphs to use, one for the Tier 1 and one for the Tier 2 when it refreshes, or the Tier 3 if they just want to let the Tier 3 go. But it's still any... Okay, it's not still anyone's game. The Glimmer of Hope is getting a little bit bigger, should be the better way to put it, but... It still is a fairly comfortable game for Pierre. They just gotta not do what they did and let Arise get annihilated like that. Yeah. They don't have another Aegis. They can't just go and get another Aegis for him, so they've gotta wait if they want that sort of advantage, but it looks like they will try for another push here. The Ancient's only got about 900 HP. Chronosphere is back up. Song of the Siren is up. So if they do, it's going to be pretty hard, but if they split up and don't let themselves get all Chronosphere, they might be able to just straight right-click it down.
Smoked up to maybe try and get try and find a pickup before that happens here. Splitting up a little bit more than they happened before. I think worst comes to worst, they can wait another 75 seconds for the double Serpent Wards. Victim can just blink in, drop those on the Ancient.
Oh yeah, that's going to be huge. Chronosphere is going to be huge. How they use their BKB is going to be huge. Yep. If they don't let Arise and Keanu get both hit by the Chronosphere, then the Ancient falls. If the Song of the Sire doesn't catch him without BKB, the Ancient falls. If both the wards get dropped, the Ancient falls. So,
oh, Illidan hexed up, Nightmare up, before King gets his ultimate up, down Chronosphere in the back of him too. That's J4 on the Bignum. Bignum, they definitely need him to be able to get a little bit of extra pushing power. Meanwhile, back to Chesh again with 3-man Ravage just to keep them away. Bignum's still alive, they only got the Banes thus far. Keanu chopping away the Ancient. This might be it with the BKB as well as the Serpent Wards. Only one set, not enough. Despite the glyph coming out, actually Keanu, well, they were able to stop him. Not able to stop the wards, and there it is, finally.
There it is.
The Ancient Falls HellRaisers drop in their second best one here up against PR.
There's only so many ways you can play against something like that. And PR, I mean, they recognized it. There is no possible way, if they got all their spells off and didn't botch an initiation, that they would not have taken that Ancient right there. So really good read by them. And of course, great hold by Power Rangers. Unfortunately, it's not going to be quite be enough. Illidan, fantastic as always on that carry roll. 16 fantasy points despite being on the losing team. But, I mean, there's only so much a Naga Siren can do when you're up against a lineup that can push you faster than you can even blink. So very well played again by Power Rangers. They kind of close out the series 1-1. Okay, it wasn't really a series. It was two best of ones. Yep. And neither one really matters in the end. But still, it just shows that both teams are pretty even. They both get themselves out of their slump. Neither one is on a losing streak anymore. And we'll look to see. Both these teams have a bit of a fresh start coming into their next couple of games. Maybe some newfound morale. As they go into more tournaments in the future.
Absolutely, and that concludes our broadcast for the night of the WePlay League Season 3. I just got word that Enemy GG versus Archon that was scheduled to start later today also has been postponed, so
if you have
plans for that, yeah. I'm not even surprised at it. I'm not even surprised. But hey, if you're waiting for that, don't hold your breath. They will play their games after they come back. Archon will play their games when they come back from the major, so it'll be a bit. But yeah, for today, thank you guys very much for watching. Sorry for the technical difficulties earlier, but hey, happens sometimes. What can you do? Hope you enjoyed my cast. If you did, you can follow me on Twitter at DragonDropDota. And also, go ahead and follow my co-caster, Chicago Ted, at TedCast, I believe.
Yep.
Alright. Definitely drop him a message. And yeah, of course, if you want to find out about the standings and about all the results in the WePlay League Season 3, as well as the schedule as up-to-date as we can keep track of, head on over to joinDOTA.com and the coverage page there. But yeah, that's about all the shameless plugs we have for today. So once again, thank you very much for watching, and see you next time.